The marathon, one of the most difficult feats a man can muster. But what about women? Legends state that Pheidippides, a Greek messenger, was sent from the battlefield of Marathon to Athens so he could announce that the Persians had been defeated in the Battle of Marathon. They say he ran 26 miles without stopping. He burst into the assembly, exclaiming, "We won!" before collapsing and dying. But with his death was the birth of the marathon. In the year of 1896, Melpomene, a young Greek woman, asked if she would be permitted to race in the Olympic marathon. Her request was denied. Not giving up, she ran the course unofficially with a time of 4 hours and 30 minutes. In 1922, the first Olympiad for women is held in Paris, sponsored by the International Federation of Women's Sports. By 1928, after petitioning time and time again, the women athletes were granted an experimental event that consisted of 5 track and field events that were to be held in the 1928 Olympics. The longest women's running event was the 800-meter race. Although the 800 was a successful race, it was excluded from the games until the 1960 Rome Olympics because of the exhausted condition of some of the women. Pierre de Coubertin summed up the world's remarks of women running in the Olympics. He said, "The Olympic Games are the solemn and periodic exaltation of male athleticism, with internationalism as a base, loyalty as a means, arts for its setting, and female applause as a reward." Before the formation of the Roadrunners Club in 1957, women were having little to no opportunities to run long distances. Women runners were not allowed to race in marathons. They resorted to running in the races unofficially. In 1966, Roberta Gibb ran the Boston Marathon. After being denied entry, she hid in the bushes and jumped into the race after it had begun. Another pioneer, Catherine Switzer, ran the Boston Marathon under the name Kay Switzer. She finished the race but had to endure an official named Jock Semple who attempted to throw her out of the race. Media focused mainly on her Syracuse boyfriend that body checked the official off of her. After the encounter, Switzer turned to a running coach and said that she was going to finish the race no matter what.
"I'm going to finish this race on my hands and my knees if I have to, because nobody believes that I can do this. And suddenly I realize, you know, if I don't finish this race, then everybody's going to believe women can't do it and that they don't deserve to be here and that they're incapable."
The media was right there to jump on it. That probably brought the whole concept of women in sports doing events that hadn't been accepted yet and made people more aware of it and got them thinking.
At this time, the newly formed International Runners Committee made parity for women's distance runners a top priority. The committee received support from the Nike Shoe Company, who put full-page advertisements in many running magazines calling for a women's Olympic marathon. The marathon was not the only race being backed. The International Runners Committee also wanted the 5,000-meter and 10,000-meter race to be added to the 1984 Olympic Games. Another key player for women's distance running's inclusion into the games was president of the International Association of Athletics Federations, Adrian Pollan. The first women's marathon officially sanctioned by the International Association of Athletics Federation was the Tokyo International. Held in 1979, Adrian Pollan traveled to Tokyo to watch the race. They say he was so impressed by the level of competition at the race that he would support the women's marathon, 5,000-meter and 10,000-meter race to be included in the 1984 Olympics. Although help from the IAAF was a very important step towards the production of the Women's Olympic Marathon, there were still many barriers to overcome. One official from the Los Angeles Planning Committee stated that the games were already too big to have more events added. Talking to Jacqueline Hansen, a Boston Marathon winner, Women's Marathon world record holder, and leader of the International Runners Committee, I got an idea of how discriminatory the International Olympic Committee was towards female athletes.
They were trying to say that we were fragile, that we were not strong enough, that it wasn't good for our femininity. They questioned whether it would damage our reproductive systems to, you know, run that far, train that hard. But all of those arguments could be put aside because a lot there were sports medicine doctors on our side who could prove that false.
Like Jacqueline said, the IOC's argument was rebutted by the American College of Sports Medicine when they stated that there exists no conclusive scientific or medical evidence that long-distance running is contraindicated for the healthy, trained female athlete. There were many powerful people in favor of the Women's Olympic Marathon. Adrian Paulin and Lord Kalanin stated their support for the marathon at an IOC meeting at the Moscow Games. However, the possibility of the race was deferred until the IOC's executive board meeting in 1981. Women's runners were becoming restless. The race had been put off for long enough. Obviously, we think it's time a women's marathon was made part of the Olympics, said Catherine Switzer. We're trying to prove to people that women are just as suited, or even more suitable, for marathoning as men. At the Los Angeles IOC Executive Board meeting in 1981, it was time to make a decision whether the women's marathon would be added to the 1984 Olympic Games. The vote would be close. The board was made up out of 9 countries, 8 of which were represented at the meeting. 5 votes were needed for a pass. 4 countries had favored the race, but Belgium appeared undecided. The next day, Belgium had made their decision. They favored the race. Catherine Switzer had heard the news and told many other marathoners.
I remember Catherine Switzer calling me in New Zealand to tell me that the women's marathon had been accepted in the Olympics. I was one of the first people she called. She was so excited.
Now all that was left was approval of the executive board's recommendation by the full membership of the IOC. In September of 1981, at an IOC meeting held in Germany, women had finally won the right to compete in an Olympic marathon. After 88 years, Melpomene's request would be fulfilled. In an email to me, Julie Esferding, one of USA's marathon runners at the 1984 Olympics, said something that really struck me. She said, "The work that was involved to make this possible was much harder, much more challenging, much more frustrating than actually running 26 miles." On August 8th, 1984, the Los Angeles Women's Olympic Marathon began. The winner was Joan Benoit Samuelson of the United States, with a winning time of 2 hours, 24 minutes, and 52 seconds. This race forever changed the world's outlook on women's long-distance running. The popularity and acceptance of females running marathons skyrocketed, and women started running all over the world. The marathon also helped the women's 5,000 and 10,000 meter run become an Olympic event.
When the women's marathon was lobbied into the Olympics before the 5,000 and 10,000, they could not use those arguments to say we weren't strong enough to run a 5 and a 10 if they'd already said we could run a marathon, right?
When I asked Jacqueline Hansen about the impact of the 1984 Women's Olympic Marathon, this is what she had to say.
And as I watched Joan Benoit running through the streets of Los Angeles, winning the first Olympic marathon, my lawyer was with me, and she actually said that think of all the girls around the world who are watching this on television, realizing that they too can become an Olympic marathoner.
Some of those girls grew up to be the professional marathoners we know today. While talking to Cheryl Trewiggy, a marathon world record holder, I asked her how her running career differed from that of her daughter, Shalane Flanagan, an Olympic bronze medalist in the 10,000 meter run.
There's more competition for her, more opportunities for her. She can make a living doing it. I had to teach school.
Although women's marathoning has become a much more appreciated sport, women's professional runners still don't get coverage and salaries equal to men. Nonetheless, women advocates of the International Running Committee successfully petitioned the International Olympic Committee to hold the 1984 Los Angeles Women's Olympic Marathon. The popularity and success of the marathon created opportunities for additional endurance events in track and field and professional women athletes today, ushering in a new era for women in athletics.